18 and 20, it does mention water baptism. Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20. So the Great Commission does include water baptism, but it does not state that water baptism is that which takes away the sins of an individual. When we look at repentance and versus baptism, what does Acts chapter 2 and verse 38 state? Acts 2:38.
Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. He shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost.
So repentance and asking for forgiveness of sins is different than water baptism. They are two different things. And if we look at the order in which they go in, it is repentance of sins, and once you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, then water baptism. Acts 2:38 teaches that. And before biblical water baptism, there has to be the believing in the gospel. If someone would please read Acts chapter 8, Acts 8, 36 and 37. And if someone would please get Hebrews 9:22 and hold on to that, Hebrews 9:22. But Acts 8, 36 and 37. If someone has Acts 8, verses 36 and 37, please.
As they went on their way, they came unto a certain water. And Jesus said, see, here is water. What does hinder me to be baptized? And Philip said, that thou livest upon thy heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God.
So before water baptism was even necessary, he had to accept that Jesus Christ was the Son of God. He had to experience salvation. Water baptism cannot remove sins. Only the blood of Jesus Christ can. If someone would please read Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22. Hebrews 9:22. So, when we look at Hebrews 9:22, is water baptism mentioned anywhere? No. It states that there is only remission of sins by one way. There's only the wiping of sins away through one method. And it was only through the blood of Jesus Christ. Water baptism does not make us children of God. We've already mentioned that it's an outward showing. When a person accepts Jesus Christ as a personal Savior, then they'll go on to water baptism to show to everyone else around them that they are different from what they were before. They were accepting Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. To put it in church terms, the old man is washed away and the new man is emerged from the water. All it is an outward sign. It does not wipe away our sins. It is just obedience to what God told us to do. He told us when we accept Jesus Christ as our personal Savior that we are to be baptized, that we may show to others through an outward sign that we accepted Him as our personal Savior. And finally, as we wrap things up here, The thief on the cross, how was he saved? Was he saved through water baptism? Did water in any way wash away his sins? Did, according to the Catholic Church, could this man have been saved? He didn't have his sins washed away. He never had a chance to take communion. I don't even know if the guy was married. But what did Jesus say to him that day? This day shalt thou be with me in paradise. And what were his actions that brought him to that point? He believed that Jesus Christ was the Messiah. He confessed and he believed, and through faith was he saved. The man on the cross, he wasn't going anywhere. He didn't have any opportunity to go out and do any penance, give to the poor. He was stuck in his situation, literally. He wasn't going anywhere. He might have been moving up and down a few inches, but he wasn't going anywhere. But yet Christ still said, your sins are forgiven. This day you shall be with me in paradise. Any thoughts, any questions, anything anyone wants to add? And that's what we were talking about with the Catholics, but when you look at the scriptures, it does not teach that in any way. Anyone else? If not, let's bow our heads and prepare our hearts for service. Gracious Heavenly Father, we give you all praise and glory for everything you've done for us and shall continue to do. Lord, we thank you that you're God who reigns on high and that there's none like you, Lord. I pray, Lord, even right now that we, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke every attack of the enemy that should come our way. We pray that you set your angels on the four corners of the property, above and below, that no attack of the enemy may penetrate. I pray that our hearts and our minds will be in one mindset and one accord, that we may worship you in sincerity and truth, Lord, that the Holy Ghost may move, making himself visible if he so chooses. Even right now, Lord, we pray that you anoint the psalm leader and the musicians, Lord, as they lead us in the songs you'd have us to sing. Anoint the, give them a special blessing as they praise you upon the string instruments and the vocal cords. Anoint the pastor as he brings forth the word today. Anoint my name, so let's bring forth the words you have us to hear. I pray that our hearts and our minds would be good soil, Lord, that they be plowed and ready to receive the message that they have, that you have for us today, that it would take root in our minds, Lord, that we may remember it throughout the week, but even greater than that, that it would take root in our hearts, Lord, that would be even transformed even farther into your very image. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.